about to be transported back in time. Jazz in the 1960s, one of the golden eras of this music, an era where the music reigned, and what we have here today is a time capsule document unlike any other. Greenwich Village, New York City. We've got a ticket for you up close, front and center, to hear Bill Evans and his trio with Marty Morell on drums and the great Eddie Gomez on bass at the Top of the Gate Club. Top of the Gate was the upstairs room to Art Dlugoff's famed club, the Village Gate. This was a remarkable evening as Bill Evans' trio are about to take the stage and perform two complete sets of music. The playing of this group is in top form. The legendary Eddie Gomez, who had been with the band for about 2 years, is playing on this recording in incredible form. You're also going to hear the very first week of performances with the trio from Marty Morell. What's so miraculous about these recordings, first of all, that they've survived the test of time and have been tucked away all these years until now. These recordings were made possible thanks to a guy named George Klabin, who is also the president and founder of Resonance Records. George, in 1968, was the director of jazz programming at WKCR-FM in New York. He would often work with various artists and record concerts. On this one very special evening, thanks to Helen Keane, who was Bill Evans's manager, George received the blessing and actually the encouragement to come down to the Top of the Gate Club and record two complete sets of music of the Bill Evans Trio.
I thought of recording Bill because I heard that he was playing live at the Top of the Gate, and I called Helen and she said, sure, you can record him. So when I went down there, I was a big fan of Bill Evans, let's put it that way. So Helen said to me, I'll meet you down there, bring your equipment, and you're gonna record him. It was October 23rd, it was a weeknight, and I got there, set up my equipment. I had this very heavy professional two-track recorder, and I had my four mics, professional mics, and I had my mixer. And I had earphones, and that was it. I ran my cables, I set everything up, and I had a little table, and the music started, set one, and I had my mics and started recording. I had to mix it live, I had to get it right in the earphones, and what you hear is what you get.
We've assembled in a compelling package with some very interesting documents, photographs, overall artifacts that most people have probably not seen before. First of all, I've got to say we have a wonderful cover photo by the great photographer Tom Coppy, which really sets the tone and the mood. It's an iconic image. We were very grateful to have his picture involved here. We have writings from Nat Hentoff, Gary Burton, Eddie Gomez, Marty Morell, Raphael Dlugoff, who is Art Dlugoff's son, George Klabin as well, who talks about the techniques that he used to get the sound quality that he did in the overall experience. We've done everything to transport you back to get a feeling of what it was like to be at that club in this moment in time.
I would like to say something about the playing on this record. I'm very proud of this because this is Bill Evans at his best. Everything that he did that night was brilliant.
Unbelievable. It may in fact be one of the best sounding Bill Evans records that was ever made.
This was a man who was exceptional. He was a spiritual human being. He was very intelligent.
This is a time capsule document like you've never heard before.
I'm really proud to be able to release this.
Thank you.
That's a pretty exciting thing.
Thank you. I agree.
All right. Well, here's my guest is GEORGE KLABIN. As you just heard, he was at that moment in time, he was the sound engineer who recorded what sounds like probably the best Bill Evans recording that exists. And that was what year?
68, I think. Yeah. And Marty Morell just joined the group. That's, as I explained, that was why I was asked to record it. And I knew Helen Keane, his manager, from other concert I put on before, et cetera. So yeah, this is one of the most important recordings that we've released on our label, Resonance Records.
You've released a lot, right? I mean,
a lot. I think there's got to be 100 overall, 100 between CDs, LPs, 10 inch, et cetera, about 100.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's a real, it's a little heavier towards instrumentalists.
Well, only yes, but I mean, there's a good number of vocalists. I love vocal jazz. And after all, the voice is the first and only real instrument before any other instrument. And the most flexible and versatile. So I'm fascinated with it. And I've been working with vocalists from all of my professional life in music, in jazz.
Yeah.
And today, one of the things I'd like to do is to play some videos of the singers that I've worked with in some cases that are on our label and a couple of cases not, but just wonderful singers that I know that you have an audience that certainly loves jazz vocals and vocalists. So I hope that this will be something interesting and even maybe educational to some people who may not know some of these singers.
Yeah, great. yeah, and before we go into that, oh, Josh Nelson is saying hello. Dan Davila has posted, he posts on allmusic.com, like he'll post links to the artists who come on. So apparently you have 301 credits there. Yes, you do.
What does that mean?
Well, allmusic.com, it's not always
301 different record. Oh, I know what you mean. Credits, yeah, like individual credits, like engineer, producer. Yeah, I know what you mean. Yeah.
So I am curious how it started for you. Did you grow up in New York or?
Well, I'll make it as concise as possible. But when I was, when I was 6 years old, I was given one of those phonographs from my father. I visited my father every summer in Brazil because my parents divorced when I was four and he had custody of me every summer, which was summer in America, winter in Brazil. It was very nice weather there in Sao Paulo. Anyway, so he gave me this wind-up phonograph, well, the old kind, you know, because they had bought the modern Victrola now with the, you know, no longer the 78 RPM. They had the more modern disc. And anyway, so I was fooling around with it and I got fascinated. He gave me some records, Rosemary Clooney, some other things. They weren't really jazz, but they were jazz-like. So I was fascinated with that. So that's when it started. And then it went from there to when I was about 11, I fell in love with Boogie Woogie. And I bought Boogie Woogie records. And that soon graduated to Errol Garner. And then Oscar Peterson. And finally, when I was about 14, I was into Bill Evans, et cetera. Oh. And I was a hardcore jazz, modern jazz fan at that point already.
Wow. And so, and then something happened where you decided to be a sound engineer.
Yeah, I was, I went to college at Columbia University. I'm a New Yorker and I came back from, I was in boarding school in high school and I came back to live in New York and wanted to be in New York. So I was able to get into Columbia University where I immediately went to the radio station and got positioned as the jazz producer of the station because there was nobody else. The jazz guy had left the year before. And so it was perfect timing. And then they let me do shows quite quickly. And I was doing a Jazz Till Midnight show starting around in my first year. And what that did is it made me think, well, what if I could get some jazz that, that people could only hear if they played my, if they heard my station, because it wasn't on a record. So I called some musicians up that I already knew. And the first guy was Roger Kellaway, actually, who was playing with the Bob Brookmeyer Quintet in those days, Clark Terry, Bob Brookmeyer. Great. That's a great band. I'm sure some of your listeners know how great they are. And I called him and said, would you like to do a recording? I had the use of a beautiful auditorium with a Steinway concert grand, and I could do it any Sunday if I just registered as a student. So it was in this hall that they had, like a concert hall, which they only used occasionally. So this was great. So I went in there. I bought equipment, very good equipment. I said, if I'm going to do this, I'm going to do it with professional microphones and a Crown tape recorder, which happened to be like a really professional machine. And then I went in there and I was recording. The very first time that I recorded Roger, I didn't have the machine yet. But anyway, after that, I got one, because I wasn't happy with the sound as when I had my own. So that's what spurred me on. And then I would do these recordings every so often and play them on my show. And as it turned out, I got to record some really important jazz. This particular promotional video that you just showed of our release of the Bill Evans Trio is one of the typical recordings that I was later on called to do, because I was willing to record if they paid me for the tape and $50 for my time, which is a lot of money back then. Believe it or not, rent on an apartment was $150. This is not in the 60s, you know, in New York. Right. So, I kept copies of all, or originals of all, and gave them copies, and I played it on my show, and that was the end of it. So I that's where I have a lot of these recordings from, and this is how I developed as an engineer. I had to teach myself. Yeah, I didn't go to school. There were no schools for recording engineers back in the mid-60s. It only started a little later. So it was wonderful, and I have a whole lot of recordings, many of which we have released from that era. And for example, I have something that cannot be released because it is, we just can't, we're not allowed to release it, but it's Keith Jarrett. When he was 21, he was brought to my studio to do some recording. He hadn't signed a contract yet. And thanks to the recordings that I made, which were at that location and at the Vanguard, I went down and did some at the Vanguard, he did get his first record deal. And these are really wonderful and important recordings. However, they remain with me secretly because we cannot release them, and we won't. We won't do anything, you know, illegal. But that's the kind of stuff I was doing. And then I started a recording studio in 1969. That's when I really became a professional engineer and had my own studio in New York. It was called Sound Ideas. And we were there for 12 years. And after the first 3 years in a small room, we moved to Capitol Records because they abandoned their studio on 46th Street in New York. And we were able to make a deal with the owner of the building to rent the space. And eventually we had two floors, two studios, and a huge studio. And that's when we really became a well-known competitive studio. And we recorded, for example, 5 James Brown albums over the entire 70s. Every time he did an album, he came to our studio. He brought his other musicians for his other label. We did scores. We had a big hit with the 5th of Beethoven, that disco hit, and many others. It was a wonderful time in recording, and it only lasted for about till the 80s, after which digital came in and everything became, everybody could buy some kind of recorder, you know, and record in their home. So I got out of that business at that point, but I really enjoyed my time there.
Wow. So that's why every time I see Resonance email or something, I'm always like, wow, I don't know where you're digging up all this stuff, but it was yours.
A part of it was. Now we've dug up a lot more. Thanks to Zev Feldman, whom you saw on the video. Zev is my co-president and really we're both at the heart of this thing. We each need each other. It's really important. He finds and puts together these beautiful packages. I work with the sound and with the concepts of the music. And what I've been doing for enjoyment is producing live jazz musicians, some of the finest living musicians that some are known, some are not that well known. And I specialize in singers. And that's how I got into singing, because during the studio days, I did work with singers as well. So I'm here to, among other things, to show people some really wonderful singers. And I have videos on all of them. So it's nice, and you don't just have to sit and listen. You can watch them. Many of the singers, to me, are actresses. A good singer doesn't just stand up on the microphone, grab the mic, and sort of hold on for dear life and sing. No matter how good, there has to be an expression of the lyric and of the music through a persona that's on stage, shall we say. So these are like that. I think that you, your audience will really enjoy it. And I've put together this list of videos. If you'd like, we could start. I could talk about the first singer, which happens to be the latest singer that I'm working with now for several years, Tawanda. Her name is a long name, Tawanda Susbrich Joachim. Who's going to remember that? So it's easier. We've all agreed, call her Tawanda. And so Tawanda is a natural, brilliant natural singer. I'm just amazed. She's only 26 now. I started working with her at 24. And she was introduced to me by Mirabai Daniels, Eddie Daniels, the famous Eddie Daniels' wife, who was a vocalist and is a very good teacher, vocal teacher. And they live in Santa Fe. And this girl was living, was going to college in Santa Fe and lived actually a little south of that. And she's turned out to be probably the best singer I've ever worked with. And she did win the Saravan contest for the 2020 contest, which actually was... the finals were held in 2021 because of the COVID situation. So she won that, and she's getting some recognition. She's playing already around at clubs like Birdland, Keystone Corner, etc. And I have, we made a release, CD release called Smile, which is available now. And we did a promo video, which we always do. And I would like to play that first so people can get an idea about her. So
absolutely.
Let's do it.
And by the way, I'm just going to sneak this in that Laurie Bell is here. And
she's here. Good. Hi, Laurie. One of my favorite people, not just a great, great musician and the best flute player, but a lovely human being, really.
She said she was very lucky that you asked her to record the music of Javon.
Yes.
In 2008. So anyway, so I'm going to bring this up. And... here we go.
My full name is Tawanda Susbrich Joachim, but I like to go by Tawanda. It has a really beautiful meaning too. It means we are more in Shona, which is a dialect that my father speaks. It's an indigenous dialect from Mozambique. I have been to Mozambique a few times, and my mom's from Germany, so I've traveled there as well. You'll get by if you smile through your fear. Why smile? Because the album's about joy and love and dreams and strength. And we started recording it during the beginning of COVID. It felt like the world was falling apart in so many ways. And I think there was so much fear. We wanted this album to be a light. I think for me especially, this album has been like medicine, because there were so many times through the past few years where I felt really, really depressed and really like giving up. So it was really important for me to record these songs during this time, to give this little bit of like medicine and hope to a world which is just changing so much. At the end of the day, I really felt like every single part of the band, all of the guys were so nice and so genuine and very patient. I try to be as humble as I can. I'm always the first to admit that I'm still learning and it's gonna take me a little time, but I would always leave the sessions feeling very, very accomplished and very in awe of everybody who's played. I love from start to finish, just been a labor of love. What a little moment I get to you. Oh, you better wait a while. I've worked with Josh so many times that I genuinely feel very, very comfortable with him. He's such a sensitive pianist. He's such a sensitive person. Gene Coy is the best drummer there is, and he's also just a teddy bear of a person. Working with Kevin Axt again on bass, he's wonderful. Especially, he's such a genius. He's very dedicated to this music and to his craft. I still feel like there's so many things that I'm learning, and working with guys that have been doing this for half of their lives already, you just gotta keep up. I always think of this thing that my sister said too when she first went to a show of mine. She told me, I don't think people understand jazz if they haven't had heartbreak. And I was like, wow, that's actually a very profound thing of you to say. Anyone who's had struggle or heartbreak or loss or has had a beautiful time in their lives expressing joy and love can relate to jazz music. That's what jazz music is. It's just pure, honest, genuine emotion.
Made like spider webs of steel. There were tiny wooden trestles, and there were bridges made of stone. I have always been a stranger. And I've always been alone. There's a bridge to tomorrow. There's a bridge from the past.
All right, she's lovely. Lovely she person.
Is. She really is. She's the real thing. And she's humble and calm. These are great qualities these days.
Yeah. So, and let's mention that Sunday, Tawanda has
a concert
here in Los Angeles at a place called the G-Spot, which is one of our favorite home venues. It's quite lovely in Mount Washington near downtown LA. And you could just go on my website and it's listed under the events and just click and it'll take you to an Eventbrite link. And yeah, we already have a pretty nice crowd coming. And the band, can you tell us who's in the band again? It's great.
Yeah, so it's Josh Nelson, whom you just saw in the video. It's going to be the same bass player as well, Kevin Axt.
Oh, yeah,
however, right. On drums, it's not the same drummer, neither of the two drummers, because there were two different bands on the record. And it's another drummer named Jamie Tate, who's excellent.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Great. So it's going to be really fun. It'll be lovely. The time is 7 o'clock to about 8:30-ish.
That's right. Yes.
And the ticket price includes some snacks and some wine and water, of course, coffee. And it's quite a nice location. This gentleman, Alan Goldman, built this room specifically for concerts. He has an incredible piano, big, long German piano. And
Eckstein.
Yeah. And then, so it's very comfortable. It's street parking. It's a suburban area. And yeah, have I left anything out?
No, I don't think so. You did a good job.
Thank you. I have looked longingly at your records for sale, and I don't know why I don't just buy them straight out, you know, but they're just in such an incredible mixture of stuff. You really have an eclectic taste in jazz.
Yeah, thank you. It's what we are is a museum. We're a nonprofit and we're a museum of modern jazz. For example, mostly jazz from the 40s on, bebop on, every form, except we have very little avant-garde jazz. It's more the kind of more musical, I mean, not musical, but I'm saying more non-avant-garde, but yeah. So I say. But having said that, the most important thing that I did in founding this is to leave it. You know, I won't be here forever, obviously. And I'd like it to, I made sure that it will continue. And then it is a place where people can go. As we go forward, we see fewer and fewer people knowing what jazz is. They've heard the word. I've asked so many young people, do you like jazz? And they go, yeah, I've heard of it. And they, you know, they say, yeah, to be polite, you know, because they don't want to feel embarrassed. They just say no. And then I say, well, have you heard of, let's say, Bill Evans? I figure if they know Bill Evans, at least that means something. And they rarely know Bill Evans. So then I realized that they haven't heard much jazz. It's not on the radio except for one station. And in many cities, there's no station. You know, small towns, most of America, it's not there anymore. And it's not sold, it's not promoted. So we're going to be the museum. We're going to keep this jazz alive in its best form. In other words, we're going to show you both the greatest artists who have been with us and are no longer with us, and the greatest who are still with us. And that's basically what our motto is creating jazz legacies, because that's what it's about, for people to understand. They want to learn about jazz. This is a good place to go.
Yeah, that's great. By the way, Gary Meek is here. Hi, Gary.
Hey, hi, Gary. One of my favorite horn players, and so versatile too.
Very, yeah. Very. Actually, do you mind if we go to your website? I'd like to show people your website. Is that okay?
My website?
Yeah, the Resonance.
Sure, sure, absolutely. Yeah.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Pretty cool. Yeah. So. Let me just move my picture out of the way. There we go. So, yeah, Roy Hargrove and Mulgrew Miller. Wow.
Yeah.
That's got to be absolutely incredible.
Yeah. These wow. are all available right now. Everything that you see. The one next to the one down next to Mingus on the right, Thad Jones, Mel Lewis. That's
yes.
opening night, the very first time they ever played. I was there. I was 19 years old. And they asked me, Alan Grant, who's a DJ that I knew, fellow DJ, he said, George, can you come down with your machine and record this wonderful new big band? So it's like the greatest players in New York will be there at the Vanguard, and they want to get a record deal. So we need to get a recording. So I said, sure. And I go down there with six microphones thinking, you know, that's all I had, actually, six inputs, six microphones. I was doing a lot of small group stuff. You know.
Oh, my God. Yeah.
And it came out fantastic, because the one room in the whole country that you can record jazz in live without having problems with echoing off the walls, you know, with that wall, the hard sound. Yeah. Is that room, because it's soft. It's all the walls are soft. So it came out so well. And that's opening night, February of 1966. And then five weeks later, I came back and did another recording with 10 mics. And that's even better sound, but they're both sound quite excellent. And so this is the whole, it's a three LPs, two CD set that I think anybody that likes big band music needs to have this, because this is history. This is the beginning of a whole different way of playing big band music, or writing it, in which the band is not always a big band with some soloists, but it can be a small group. And then all of a sudden the rest of the band plays orchestrations. And then all of a sudden they come together as a big band, then they go apart and so on. And the whole thing is written with that open concept, which is so brilliant. And Thad Jones wrote many of the compositions, including he was very famous for compositions that, like one of them is on Tawanda's record, A Child Is Born. That's one of his great compositions. So it's a great recording. It's really good sounding, and it puts you right there. You hear the excitement in the room. The musicians are really excited, and it's a Rolls Royce of the finest studio. And because in those days, you know, these jazz musicians made money going to studios, and there was a lot of recording of with actual instruments, you know, and so it was great. I mean, you have Bob Brookmeyer, you have Eddie Daniels when he was just a kid, and you have you name it. It's royalty. So that's a record I do think people should.
That is very appealing to me. I always, you know, I grew up, my dad was a sax player, and he had big bands, so I grew up listening to that. But when I heard Thad Jones and Mel Lewis in college, I was blown away. And I remember I went to Berkeley. So I was in Cambridge and I went to see them, and they had Dee Dee Bridgewater, who probably wasn't much older than me. And I was the only one who jumped out of my seat and applauded her standing up. I was so blown away by, you described it so well, how their orchestra was not, it wasn't your typical big band, you know, your old big band stuff. It was modern and utilized these different forms within the piece, you know. And the musicians must have been excited out of their minds.
They were so happy, you know? And they ended up getting a record deal, so it was all good. Speaking of Dee Dee, back in the 70s, I guess mid-70s, there was a movie called Coffee, which was a movie that was, it was one of those movies that was a sensationalist movie, you know, with a lot of violence and so on. But the heroine was a woman, a black woman. It was her name, actress, who was a very good actress, Pam Grier. Anyway, the score was written by Roy Ayers, and Roy was a friend of mine. So he brought this project into me, and I actually was the engineer, because we had many engineers, you know, we had two rooms, but I wanted to do it. So in walks this singer to sing some of there were some vocal parts. And I think she must have been 21, 22. That was Dee Dee Bridgewater, married to Cecil Bridgewater, who is a well-known jazz trumpet player. And so I started recording and listening, and I said, oh my God, this is like the next Sarah Vaughan. I mean, she absolutely was spectacular.
And gorgeous.
Woo! Gorgeous, yeah, and very
still gorgeous, but at that age she was really gorgeous. Wow.
Yeah, she was a gorgeous girl. So that, again, we come back to the singers. I worked with singers. They would come in and out, you know, as part of the fact that we were in New York, and it was a center of music in many ways. And so that's how I got to really learn about singers and love them so much, because they could do so much. I would like to continue with more of Tawanda's, then we'll go to some other singers. This is an actual song from the record, a video of that song that we made. So I thought people might enjoy that. It's Sting wrote it.
Yeah, okay. It's a great song.
Is the prime sun. My eyes are too weak. How cold is a heart when it's warmth that I seek? You watch every night. You don't care what I do. I'd go out of my mind, but for you. I'd go out of my mind, but for you.
Yeah.
So we go in different directions with her. We don't just do straight jazz. She can sing many different types of songs, and that makes it even better. And I'm a believer in not just staying in the jazz idiom for song selection. And so we have that on the record. We have a whole bunch of different ones, ranging from even Yvonne Lynn's, Milton Nascimento to Bridges, that one, and this one you heard, and then we have I can't remember the name. Hold on, let me look out here on the record. Sack Full of Dreams. You know that song, right? Sack Full of Dreams.
Yeah.
And what it is, by the way, this is the album's called Smile. It's a positive album. It's about positivity in a time when people can use some, I'll tell you that. So all of the songs are in that direction. Smile and I'm All Smiles is the title tune, and so on. So that's Tawanda. If it's okay, I'd like to continue with another wonderful singer that I've worked with and recorded. I've made three CDs with her. She's from England, and that's the problem, because if you're going to sing jazz and really be successful, it's better to live in America. I mean, let's face it, this is the place. So anyway, she is remarkable, I think, one of the greats. So her name is Polly Gibbons, and some of you who are watching, I'm sure, know her. Some may not. Some have worked with her, if you're musicians, like certainly, Tamir Hendelman, Kevin Axt, and numerous others have worked with her, recorded either at my studio, recorded live, recorded various places. So I'd like to play what I think is a tour de force. This was recorded in my studio because we could have an audience of 60 people there. So we had an audience, and this is with Tamir and with Ray Brinker and Kevin Axt and this wonderful Graham Dechter on guitar. And it's Love for Sale, this well-known song, and see what she does with it, all right?
Okay. Thank you.
Who'da, who'da, who am I? Who would like to sample my supply? If you want to try my wares, follow me and climb the stairs. Oh, love, the moon, the nail. Oh, let the poets fight for love in their jumping. Ways I know every time I go flooding. Thank you for the day. If you want a bit of love, I've been through a bit of love. I did the new love, I did the new love. Everything but true love. Oh, love, for sale. Advertising young love for sale. If you want to try my ways, follow me and climb the stairs. Love for sale.
That was pretty exciting.
What I say is she's really not a singer. She's a musician who sings. I mean, she's absolutely got a sense of rhythm, creativity. She's unafraid of doing anything in the moment. She even has a patented thing that she does, like she stutters. I don't know if you heard at the beginning, kind of a stutter. She'll throw that in a little bit in some songs, rhythmically. And I just think she's absolutely the height of what jazz singing can be. That doesn't mean that, you know, there aren't people who don't think other people are as great. It's not about being greater than anyone, but she's unique. I have never heard another singer that does that the way she does that. And for that, I give her a lot of kudos. And so I did 3 records with her, and it was a joy to work with her. But she does live in England, and that's a problem getting her work. You know, it's a big deal to fly somebody back and forth all the time. So,
yeah, and I've met people who are famous in Europe, and yeah, work all the time. They're famous, but nobody knows them here.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. It's so, it's a funny that way.
It is. There's a, if it's okay.
Before we move on.
Yes.
Yeah. I actually prefer to talk a little in between.
Sure. Let's do that.
And I'm going to go back to your site, because to me, this is like a really great representation of you. And also, like, for instance, the lost album from Ronnie Scott's. So obviously that wasn't your recording, right?
No, most of these aren't, by the way. I can only say, you know, I pointed out a couple, but great majority of them are not my recordings, that I did not do them. Yeah.
And so I'm just curious, how do you come across them? People know that you're looking, or you look?
It's a combination. Yeah. Zev Feldman is the jazz detective. I had, as I said, a number of recordings already in my possession or knew about, but he has come up with most of these. And I told him, I said, once we get started, watch people come out of the woodwork with all kinds of wonderful recordings that were not even known to exist. And that's exactly what's happened. For example, we're coming out with an Art Tatum that was recorded live 1953, 3 years before he passed, when he was at his peak in Chicago at a club called the Blue Note, which was the Chicago Blue Note, nothing to do with the current Blue Note, as far as I know. Anyway, he is at his best. The owner recorded his trio for a week. It was about a week, and has all these recordings that he made, and he didn't do anything with them. And then the guy passed away and left everything to his children. And they, of course, there was no more club or anything. They found these recordings, and there's some very, very important recordings, this being one of them. And we were able to obtain these, and we'll be putting them out in the fall of this year. So these are some of the ways that we get recordings. Others are people call us and say, you know, I have this, I'd like to sell you these tapes, or would you put them out? There's all kinds of ways.
Yeah.
And so that's how we've come across these. And Nat King Cole, by the way, that was a Grammy nominated set, 7 CDs and 10 LP box set, that I think is one of the most important historical recordings in the sense that it's the earliest Nat King Cole, 1936 to 1943, which was a time at which he was just starting to do some 78 RPMs on some small labels. And then towards the end of it, he got on Decca. So most of it is transcriptions, which was the way that they recorded before records were that popular. They were made on a lathe, and they were then duplicated with a press, and they would send them to radio stations who would then use them as kind of either background music or in between shows, etc. And then they would discard them, and they would get new ones and so on. And collectors collected these transcription discs, which were much larger than, I think they were 15-inch diameter, something like that. Huh. I can't remember. And so these were collected and then eventually restored. The sound, of course, had some noise that was removed very skillfully by a gentleman that we work with. These are really important recordings, and they're excellent, musically superb, and they're very well, very good sounding considering the time they were recorded. So that's one of the best things we put out in the last few years in that sense of very, very important historically. And remember, we're a museum. It's like when you get a Renoir, if you're an impressionist museum, you want to hang it on the wall, and you want everybody to be able to access this. And that's what it'll be. They don't have to buy this. They can hear it on us on all of those different websites that play music. So it's part of history now.
Wow, this is pretty incredible. And look at all the artists.
Yeah, look at that.
It's a huge list.
Yep.
Yeah. Claudio Roditi. I was at Berkeley, he was there.
Oh, yeah, really? Okay.
Yeah, that was a long time ago.
Yes.
Eric Dolphy, one of my favorites.
Yeah.
And yeah. Cool. Wonderful. Oh, Toninho Horta? Huh.
Yes, yes. Remember, I'm sort of half Brazilian.
Oh, yeah.
Side. You know, yeah. I was born in America, but. Yeah, and so I speak the language, and I grew up with bossa nova because I was at the perfect time. When I was a teenager, bossa nova had started in the 60s.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, that's awesome. So you speak Portuguese?
Fluently, yeah.
Oh, man, that's cool. I wish I did. I sing a little in Portuguese, but I wish I spoke it. It's a beautiful language.
It is. It's much nicer than Portuguese from Portugal is very tough, hard. And the Portuguese from Brazil is really a mixture of French and Portuguese. So it's softer.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Oh, this is pretty incredible. I love him. Okay, so now I'm ready.
Okay.
I'm gonna move on to.
I like to play Miss Celie's Blues because also it has Roger Kellaway on it. And Roger, it's just Roger and Polly, impromptu. Roger came to one of her concerts that I had at my studio in front of an audience, and I asked him to come, and I said, would you sit in and play Miss Celie's Blues with her? And this is what came out.
Yes. Okay, great. Sorry, I didn't mean to cut you off.
Go right ahead.
Okay.
Just discussing the last composition. This is I'm one of seven children, really, and got lots of sisters. There's six girls and one boy. And this has got a sister edge to it, and I've got one of my sisters here, so I'm going to be singing this for you, Es. Sister, I'm keeping my eyes sister, I got news for you. I've been down that lonesome road, and I've seen a lot of suns going down. Trust me, no low life's gonna run me around. So let me tell you something, sister. Remember. No one's gonna steal your stuff away, my sister. You, the sun is gonna shine, oh
She's a lot of fun. She's not afraid of anything. You could hear she's just does whatever she wants. She has the voice, she has the ability, and it's a joy to watch, in my opinion. I just don't know too many of the singers that could do it that way, you know, with such a freedom and be in the moment so well. But then again, you know, everybody has their taste. That's just the way I feel about her.
Yeah. I have a question here about I'm sure it applies, but it's what is your feeling about sending musicians charts who are in different areas, you know, for them to record their part and send their music back?
Well, the only time I do that is when we have to. Like, I'm working on Yvonne Lynn's new album. We're producing it for my label. And one of the we needed a trumpet part, and so we called a few different people and finally end up with Randy Brecker. And Randy Brecker didn't need to come all the way over here to do an overdub of like a 3-minute solo and part. So obviously that's the kind of thing we do, but we want the rhythm section there. We want everything live. It's really this collaborative idea is very nice, but it's not very smooth in the sense that there's time differences, there's all kinds of differences that can come up. So we don't normally do anything like that.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, that was a good question, Mark.
Yeah.
Yeah. Are you still running your studio?
Oh, very much so. Absolutely.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. And I think we spoke of this, but are you having live performances?
No, that's not anymore. I tell you, it's just been so difficult to get people to come to anything these days. You know, especially the audience that we had were older people who really grew up with jazz. And many of those people either have passed away, literally, because we started about 20 years ago, almost 20 years. Or they simply, you know, they're not interested in driving. It's a huge amount of space around, you know, the LA area, and they come from all over. So we just had to stop doing that. It's sad.
Yeah.
Here we are doing Alan Goldman with Tawanda, and that's the kind of thing that's manageable and once in a while and intimate, and he has a beautiful sound in his room with that piano. I've been there. So I think that people will enjoy that. The intimacy of it is really great.
Yeah.
That's what I'm doing in that area now.
Yeah, I think you're right. I mean, you know, time moves on, every venue closes.
Yeah, that's another sad thing. You know?
Yeah, it is. But Alan Goldman's, thank goodness we still have. So, yeah, it's such a nice, beautiful spot. And I'm sure I'm looking forward to it. I think Tawanda is going to be just so lovely in it, you know. Going to be beautiful.
Yeah, we're doing some new material. We're working out literally on Friday. It's written by Josh, some arrangements, and we're going to get the whole band together and just go over it all. So it's all going to be real professionally done and ready to be played. And there's a song in there which I don't know if many people have heard of this song. We just added it. It's called Every Time I See a Butterfly. It was written by this man whose name I don't remember, but his show name, his professional name was Tiny Barge, like a barge. I never heard of this guy, but Les McCann did this on a record. And it was so moving that I said, I've got to do this song. So I had it taken down. You couldn't even get sheet on it or anything, you know. I had it taken down and we've rehearsed it and we're going to do it. And it's a beautiful, beautiful song. I will leave it at that.
Cool.
And many other good songs, you know, but all kinds of jazz, swinging jazz, ballads, because Tawanda does it all. She's, you know, just marvelous.
Yeah, I saw her last month or so at a beautiful show at Vitello's that Dori Amarillo produced for a songwriter from San Francisco, and Tawanda, and there were several singers.
Right, I heard about that. Yeah.
Yeah, Sydney Jacobs and Tawanda, and two other singers whose names I'm not that familiar with, but they all did just beautifully. You know, they had their special songs.
Yeah. Yeah,
it was quite beautiful, and they were all sitting there the whole time on the stage.
Sure.
And the whole thing was just very classy and wonderful.
And it's gone now, Vitello. Gone.
Strangely. Yeah. And now I'm I took over booking the strangest room. I don't know if you've ever even wandered through Kulak's woodshed.
No, I don't even know about it.
Well, I'll just be brief about this, but it's in North Hollywood on Laurel Canyon and Magnolia. And it's been there 23 years. But the room, well, first of all, it's definitely supported like singer-songwriters and acoustic rock, you know, blues. But it's an unusual room. It's not a club, so to speak. It's actually a location where you get this fabulous stereo moving camera live edited video and Pro Tools if you want. And so, and they have 49 seats in it, but it doesn't sell food or alcohol, and it's like being on a TV stage. It's really interesting. So I kind of re-met this guy about a month ago, and I've been really jumping in and like making stuff happen. So I have a whole bunch of jazz people lined up for it. But anyway, so it's like Vitello's, I mean, it's still there, but they took away the music, the performance.
Yeah, it's just a restaurant.
Yeah, it's really a shame. And then, but then in the area, this kind of odd venue came up, you know, of Kulak's Woodshed. So
good. Good.
Everything, it fluctuates, right?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah.
If I may, I'd like to introduce another wonderful singer who is very, very little known, unfortunately, because Well, it's a long story, but she lives in Kansas City. She was a former fashion model, 6 feet tall, beautiful, beautiful woman, and a great singer, and has a tremendous range all the way down to baritone. It's extraordinary what she can do. And she's a pure jazz musician, grew up with a house full of kids that had to play an instrument, and the father was a jazz sax player in Kansas City. And, you know, Kansas City, the home of jazz, really.
Yeah.
So anyway, her name is Angela Hagenbach. That's her married name. She goes by that name, H-A-G-E-N-B-A-C-H. And so actually, I did a record with her on my label, which is called The Way They Make Me Feel, because it's that's the song The Way He Makes Me Feel from Yentl, Michel Legrand. So it's all the great three great composers, Legrand, Mancini, and Mandel. We do their songs, and we do it with a jazz group. And on some tunes, we have string section. And Kuno Schmidt, this wonderful arranger, did the arrangements. Tamir Handelman arranged a lot of it, too. And so I'm going to play a video that she did at the Vic. Do you remember the Vic?
I do. I sang there a bunch.
Good. So the Vic was a place where I restarted my recording, because I had gotten away from it. And in early 2000, I was introduced to that place and ended up recording a lot of shows there. And so one of these, we made a video too. I hired some video guys to come in and do this with this lady, Angela. So this has Tamir on it. It has a really wonderful guitarist. Have you ever heard of this guy, Danny Embry? He's really one of the best.
Yeah, I used to work with him here.
Okay, yeah, good. And then we have Dan Lutz on bass. He's wonderful. And the drummer was named Doug Allwater, and he's from Kansas City. So this is a wonderful video of her live, and she sings Night and Day. And listen to the very last note she sings. Oh my God, it's so far down. Anyway, let's see. Let's hear it.
Okay.
Like the beat, beat, beat of the tom tom, when the jungle shadows fall. Like the tick, tick, tock of the stately clock as it stands against the wall. Like the drip, drip, drop of the raindrops when the summer showers through. So a voice within me keeps repeating you, you, night and day. You are the one. So that this longing for you follows me wherever I go, and this time it won't be through until let me spend my
Unbelievable. Unreal.
Very interesting sound.
Again, a totally unique singer, an actress, of course, a model, and she shows it, and that's fine. It's great. Some people may be put off with all of the movements in the end and the looks, but I think it's great. I think you have to, you know, look at what this is, and, you know, some people say, oh, she's not strictly singing jazz, you know, and please, you know, I'm showing all kinds here. I don't know anyone like her. Let's put it that way.
Well, one thing I noticed right away was your beautiful, the recording of her voice was surprising from a live recording. It was gorgeous.
Yeah, good old Shure 58. That's the greatest vocal mic for live that there is. You know the secret of the 58, besides being calibrated for vocal range, is it has, the rejection of sounds behind it is amazing. If you start to move behind it, it drops the volume very quickly. So it doesn't pick up a lot of the orchestra, which is really annoying because then you hear that mixed in, et cetera. So it's a great mic. It's been around for, I don't know, 60 years or 70 years. And they can't do any better. They play around with all these new microphones and they want to charge thousands of dollars and there's this great, and they're not any better.
I've loved my 58 for years. And I realized a long time ago that sometimes, like, you have this, you know, great sound system, like really incredible. Yeah. And you're trying to use like this, you know, incredible mic, and it doesn't sound great. And you put a 58 on.
And there it is. Bingo.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah. that's, you know, that's Angela. She did go, in 2015, she competed in the, or I think it was 2015, she competed in the Sarah Vaughan contest. I had her go in there. And even though she was, at that time, she was already over 50 years old. This is what you saw, she was younger, because this was in 2004. And she's a beautiful woman still, I mean, to this day. But she competed and she got second place because, as I was told later by the guy who's behind the scenes, who puts this thing together, he said, she was just, they had to pick a young girl singer. And they picked someone that I don't think anything ever happened to her career, but she got second place. I thought it was pretty amazing.
I don't know why on earth they would care about the age. You know, it's just, that's.
Well, I think if you think what it's about the next young, great jazz singer in the mold of Sarah Vaughan, even if they don't sound like Sarah Vaughan. It's that idea, let's find the next young one so she can have a long career. And this lady was much further advanced. So yeah. They just had to, and she was just so much better than anyone on the stage that day, that they were in a quandary to what to do. So they figured out, just, you know, give her second place.
I remember when Shirley Horn won. Was it that contest or the Thelonious Monk contest? Or this was probably
Shirley Horn, and she was much older than when she won it.
Yeah, it was just 20 years ago. And yeah. It was, you know, everybody was like, yeah. Yeah, it was great.
Speaking of Shirley Horn, the next project with Tawanda is going to be Shirley Horn. I'm actually going to have a script written. I'm going to try to get like a whole act together with the great songs, because she could be a representative of Shirley Horn. She has all the attributes and she can sing the music of Shirley Horn her own way, but beautifully. And I think that she's got the image, you know, she's tall, beautiful, and could be on Broadway one day. I see Tawanda on Broadway because she can act. And you can see it in the video that we did. The second one was obviously not recorded live, right? She mouthed over her recording.
Right.
And we did that on purpose. So, you know, that's the way. I mean, she's in a booth, you know, with her hair up and just jeans on singing normally in the studio. So,
yeah.
So it gives you an idea of what she could do. And so anyway, I'm working. That's my next project.
Oh, cool. Very cool. I'm sure you're not at a loss of projects.
No. Speaking, it's such good timing that you mentioned Lena Horne, because Lena Horne sang this next song, which Tawanda, this is the first song that Tawanda sang when I met her. It was an overdub on a track that I had, that nobody had done it particularly well. So I just had this track, and it's a song called Black Is. Have you heard that song?
No.
It was written by Marissa Dodge, a very little known but wonderful songwriter. So I recorded a track with Marissa, but she never did the vocal. And so luckily Tawanda could handle the track at the pitch that it was at. And what you're going to hear now is, it's a video, but it's really just some photos of her because we don't have a real video, but it's still some beautiful photos fading in and out while she's singing this really beautiful song. And I think that a lot of your viewers have not heard this song before, so it should be interesting. Okay. So we're going to that one.
Is earth so green can
that beautiful? And you know what? This is so interesting that you brought up Lena Horne. The only person that's recorded this before this recording is Lena Horne on her Blue Note album, which you may recall was, I think, one of the last albums she did. And it was a beautiful album. I had not heard the album, and I got this directly from the composer, Marissa Dodge, but then realized, she said, oh, Lena Horne recorded. So again, the connection is very interesting that you brought it up.
And who did this arrangement?
This was Tamir with Gary Meek again. Gary, if you're there, you're getting played a lot tonight.
And, this was a beautiful arrangement.
Beautiful arrangement. Beautiful. Tamir is brilliant. You know, Josh and Tamir.
And I think Tawanda shines in this style.
She does. She does very well in that. And that blew me away because, remember, I had not heard her sing. And so I said, well, come in and do this. Can you do this track? Because I have the track with a vocal and without. So she learned it. She came in and did it. And I was really stunned. This is a great singer, I said, at this point. And so we went from there. And so I'm glad to play this because it's also such a beautiful song. And the lyric is so beautiful and special, you know. There was a singer I worked with who I produced a record for. It never came out on my label because I didn't have a label, but on her label back in at the Vic. This was done live at the Vic, but this particular recording was done later. She went on her tour somewhere. That's so good. It's brilliant. Her name is Annie Selleck. I'm sure you know her.
I do.
Annie is a great actress as well as a singer because look what she does on this. This is absolutely brilliant stuff. It's funny. It's a sense of humor, dramatic, great singing, wonderful arrangement, you name it, it's all there. It's two songs together, Is You Is or Is You Ain't My Baby and Hit the Road Jack. And so let's play that one. People are gonna love it, I hope.
Yeah, she was around a lot for a while in LA and then kind of disappeared.
Yes.
Somebody new, or is my baby still my I wonder. This is one of those questions that needs answering, don't you think? I can see that you're worried about the love affair described in this situation. Well, let me tell you what happened. I walked up to his gate. I knocked on his gate. Just like that. That's our secret knock. Took him a little while to come to the door. He finally came to the door, a little disheveled, you know, like putting himself together. And he's like, hey, baby. And I said, hey, what are you doing? And he's like, oh, nothing, you know, I just been working. I said, well, you haven't answered my calls and stuff. And I'm, is you, is all, is you, ain't my baby. And he said, oh, baby, I'm your baby. I love you. And I was like, well, then give me a kiss. So he said, okay. So he leans in for a kiss. We lean in, we're like. And I smelled Lancome Miracle. And I haven't worn that in like 5 years. Something's going on. I started to get angry. I started to get that kind of angry that it's like a spinning in your stomach and it turns into fire and then it spins faster and it comes up through your chest and up your throat and out of your mouth. And the thing that I said to him, well, I'll get back to that. As this anger was spinning inside, I kept, these words kept coming to me that a girlfriend of mine said once. She said, huh. What do you call a woman who knows where her man is 24/7? A widow! So at that point, I knew it was over, and I got upset, and I said, hit the road, Jack, and don't you come back.
Hit, hit. Annie, man, nice to see her sing.
Yeah, and this is an example for young people. You know, if somebody young didn't know jazz and they saw this, they'd be entertained. It's got all the elements, you know, musically, and her singing or acting, the whole thing. It's fun, and it's a story, you know, that everybody relates to. So that's a really good way to bring jazz back, if you want to call it that, or to spread it more. People like her. Now, she's not doing that much because it's hard to get work singing jazz. It just is. She's from Nashville, and Nashville is a big music town, but not a jazz town. There's a little bit of jazz, and she's hung with all those people. They know her very well, but how many times can you play there? And so, of course, she goes out and tours, but more and more, it's become more difficult for her. So that's the tragedy of that.
That's a shame, because she was always like you just saw her.
Exactly.
She was really good, great singer, and, you know, very natural and connected to the music and everything.
Yes, she is, by all means. So another singer that you know, Greta Matassa, is very underrated, in my opinion. She's a fine teacher up in Seattle, and she sings. She's, you know, been all over the place. But she's not one that has become famous or booked by major auditoriums, etc. And I think that this video, which was done in my studio live in front of an audience, is really, really fun. It's another one of those videos where it's acting and music all together. And surprisingly, the bass player, who's her boyfriend, Clipper, is just wonderful. And he does the most fabulous Louis Armstrong, and she does Ella. And so let's play that. It's a song called You Won't Be Satisfied.
Okay. I love them. Stayed at their house.
Oh, good.
Yeah. They are cool.
A few years back, about 10 years ago, actually, I put together a tribute to Ella Fitzgerald and Betty Comedy. And in the show, we had a section where we did Ella Fitzgerald's work with Louis Armstrong. And at the time, I had a pianist that we were kind of a decent Louis Armstrong. Really, actually, sounded more like Tom Waits, really, was my. And it was okay, you know, people just like, ooh, wow. And then he left the band, and I turned to the rest of the rhythm section, and I said, oh, well, show a couple weeks, and they think they could do a Louis Armstrong, just for like one thing. The Clipper, who would like, I've known for years, if I'd never heard him sing a note. And he tried, you know. And he started singing, and it was just uncanny. And so we're going to do that for you this afternoon. We hope you enjoy. This is Ella Fitzgerald and Louis Armstrong's duet from about 1946. This is You Won't Be Satisfied Until You Get Now.
Wow, this was a while back.
Until you break my heart, you're never satisfied until the tears
rise.
I try to shower you with love and kisses. But all I ever get from you is nagging and dragging. My forehead is sagging. The way you toss my heart around, I told you, cry. I bet you wouldn't like it if I did the same. You're probably happy, tearing all my dreams apart. But you won't be satisfied until you break my heart.
I won't be satisfied until you break my heart. Never, never, never satisfied until the teardrops start. I'm trying to shower you with loving kisses, don't you know? But all I ever get from you is you won't
Yeah, they're great. That really did sound like LL Louis.
It did. It's fantastic. He could be hired to do that if they needed it. And he's a boyfriend. That's what's so great. You know, they're a couple and they play together. And then she discovers, as she told, that he did this. She had no idea that he could do this until he did.
Yeah, that's funny.
Extraordinary.
That's really
funny. Really, really. These are some of the great moments, you know, which we preserve, I think. And so, and speaking of one more singer that I think you know that's really talented is Aubrey Logan. I think Aubrey Logan is almost a genius level at what she does, because she's the complete thing. She writes, arranges, sings, produces. She's like a one-man show. You kind of wind her up and just watch, you know, not too much you have to do. So here's a little thing we did at our studio. It's a video, and it's also on our website. It's I Feel the Earth Move, that song. It's not a jazz song, but and it's done with her band, and it's great stuff. And so let's play it. Okay.
All righty.
I feel the skies tumbling down. I feel my heart start to tremble whenever you're around. Oh, baby, when I see your face, mellow as the month of May,
couldn't stand it when you look at me that way. I feel the earth move under my feet. I feel the skies tumbling down. And I feel my heart start to tremble. My heart start to tremble when you're right.
Wow, I haven't seen her in a long time.
Yeah, she's something else. She really is another entertainer. Look, that's her logo. Look,
that's very cute.
And she winks. It winks.
Oh, and let me see.
Watch. That's her little logo that she puts at the end of every big. We didn't come up with that. She just gave us that. She's the real. She's the whole thing. You know. She moved to Austin. She was here in Pasadena. She moved to Austin a few years ago, had a baby, took a little bit of time off. And now, who knows? She's probably out touring with the baby. find a way to work the baby into the show. No, I'm just kidding. But she's great. She's great. And we did a record with her. It's on our label. And it is jazz, but it's not all jazz. And this is kind of a isn't that Carole King who wrote that song? Isn't it Carole?
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. So it's, you know, she chooses whatever works and makes it work.
And so I'm curious, who is House Galliano? And you have
that's a fabulous recording. What happened is I was recording Christian House, this great violinist, jazz violinist. I've done 4 records with him and I wanted to have, it was all Southern music. We called it Southern exposure because it was all Southern music from meaning down South, and Brazilian was involved. And so I was able to get this great accordion player, Richard Galliano, who is the world's absolutely bar none world's greatest jazz accordionist. And he came over and we did. I also ended up doing a record with him later, too, because he was so happy with
what from Europe or Brazil.
He's from France. His name is Italian, but he was born in France.
I think I've heard him. I think he used to make records with a clarinetist? There was this wild group that was a duo, and it was the best accordion player I've ever
heard. He's number one. So yeah, let's play that. That's from the record. And the song is called Taboa Santa, which in Portuguese slang, it means, are you okay, my dear? And so check this out. This is pretty fantastic, virtuosic stuff. And it's funny beginning.
Oh, I know, they're worse today. Who is that? That's the, yeah, he's got the... Now you made me focus on it. Thank you.
I mean, that's about as prolific as you get, or so, just amazing stuff. That violin solo, I've never heard anything like that. It's just extraordinary.
That's really amazing.
It is. It's amazing. That's a good way of saying it. Yeah. And that's the composer, Egberto Gismonti, who we did a tribute album to with Eddie Daniels called Heart of Brazil. And then we did I guess we don't have time to play. I was going to the Ivan Lins promotional video for the Night Kisses, this is not Ivan Lins recording that I'm doing. This is with Eddie Daniels. We did a tribute to Ivan Lins. So I don't know if you have time to play that. We're at the hour. So I don't know if you go over to a few minutes or what.
Not a big deal.
All right.
That was incredible.
It was amazing.
Yeah.
What else can you say? You know, the best of we've shown everybody today a whole range.
Yes.
Okay.
Really incredible.
I play the clarinet, the saxophone, and the flute, which I played for many, many years, and then I kind of put it away for a little while. It suddenly came back to me, and I'm in love again with the flute. So you're going to hear some flute playing on this album, which is the music of Ivan Lins, beautiful Brazilian composer, just romantic. When I hear his music, it makes me feel like kissing your loved one, the sensitivity of subtlety.
I'm a very big fan of the music of Ivan Lins. For many, many years, I've enjoyed playing his music. It's very romantic, but it's also adventurous, and it calls upon Eddie and me to be creative, to listen to each other, and to have a kind of musical dialogue.
This group of players was phenomenal. And I'm not talking about guys that worked on my thing only. I mean, everybody that's involved in this project, it's a cast of champions for sure.
My mission was to reharmonize the music. The whole idea behind it is to create something in the spirit of jazz. I was trying to give Ivan's music another profile.
We have the Harlem String Quartet, so beautiful. They were on our first album, Heart of Brazil. Probably the best string quartet ever.
Happy when we got this call from George to do a second album with Eddie. Not only we love the result of the first album, but we really like working with Eddie and with all of these fantastic arrangers and group of musicians.
There was a conversation at some point, how about if we actually either write or just put a little bit more mix into the quartet writing. All these musicians are getting to know the Harlem Quartet, and they decide, you know what, these guys can do it, so let's write even higher parts.
We met Eddie when we were in Santa Fe for a concert. The Chamber Music Society we were there performing with told us he was in town and asked if we'd be interested in collaborating some of our jazz tunes with Eddie. And we said, sure.
We were sharing the stage with him, and it was a mostly classical concert. We included him on some of our jazzier arrangements, and we also premiered a piece for clarinet plus string quartet. And ever since then, we've stayed in touch, and we've done so many projects together.
I made my list. living as a musician in New York as a studio rat by working for Mark James and Dave Grusin. They're both musicians that I respected so much when I worked with them.
It's intimidating to have the likes of Bob James, Dave Grusin, and Kuno Schmidt in the room as you're playing, but they're so open and wonderful people that they just want you to be you. They were open to my ideas and the music, and it seemed to make sense with the arrangements. I'd say this moment is probably one of the highlights of my young career.
Get away from the kind of pure Brazilian feel. We wanted to make it a natural American jazz feel as well.
It's jazz, it's Brazilian music, there's pop, there's a lot of different influences. It's a project that will please everybody. I reharmonized all tunes. I had longer introductions, more space for improvisation.
This record will appeal to music lovers no matter what genre they favor. It's a cornucopia of colors and flavors.
You're gonna hear some saxophone that will make you cry. And some clarinet play with the warmth of the clarinet and the flute. Just kind of took me over. As soon as I got back to it, it was like a kiss in the night, holding this flute, and I couldn't get it away from my face. I just started playing it, and I had to keep it there. I hear Yvonne's voice on a lot of these songs, and it's so beautiful and touching, and it brings back romance, tenderness, love, holding your sweetheart's hand. We're all holding hands. Guys can hold your hands, you can hold the paw of your dog also, holding paws. Yvonne, I hope you're gonna love it and feel that I and the musicians and the writers added something to your music that rings true to you. It makes you happy.
Lovely.
Yeah, very proud of that. And I got to give a lot of credit to the gentleman who's been with me now for, let's see, how many years has it been? 15 years at least. His name is Jose Francisco Gala. And he developed, he came as an engineer, just graduating from that school in Hollywood. You know which one, I can't remember the name of it. It's a school. Yes, Musicians Institute. He came from there, and he was hired as an apprentice for a while, and then took over and became my main assistant recording engineer and beautiful director. He shoots the videos. He takes the footage. He edits it. He chooses the music. I just let him do his thing. It's so creative and brilliant, and that is a perfect example. He used some stock footage, as you saw, beautifully, and everything he does is just full of taste and beauty and sensitivity. So it's great, you know, having the people with me like Zev and this gentleman and myself and a few other people. It's a team, a small team, and we really can do some great stuff. I mean, we're keeping it alive. We're keeping jazz alive in the sense of for other generations of people to go back and see what really is great music.
Was that from the record Heart of Brazil?
That was Night Kisses.
Oh, okay.
Heart of Brazil was the music of this gentleman we just played before, Taboa Santa, with the violinist and the accordion. That was his music. So we did an album dedicated to him called Heart of Brazil. That was Egberto Gismonti. He's considered really one of the great geniuses in modern music. the other one was Night Kisses was Eva Lins.
I see. Okay. Wow. Very, very, very gorgeous. Dan Davila said, were they both Grammy nominated?
Yes, they were. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, congratulations, George. Everything was just so beautiful. And, you know, it's nice to hear about your long, long relationship with jazz. And yeah, it's beautiful. It's a beautiful thing.
Well, thank you. I'm honored to be able to do it. And we'll continue to do it for as long as I can. And people should look out for our website for all kinds of information, new stuff. And hopefully some of you come and attend the concert with Tawanda, which will be this coming Sunday at 7:00. Those of you who can't, who don't have to be glued in front of a TV set watching the Super Bowl. I'm the type of guy, watch the highlights later. I don't have the patience for the whole game with all the advertisements and all that stuff.
Yeah.
So, you know, even if I wasn't.
Time.
Doing, yeah. Yeah.
So just to remind people, if you would like to come see Tawanda sing at the G-Spot in Mount Washington near downtown LA on Sunday evening, go to my website and go to the events link and you'll see it, and it will take you to the Eventbrite link. And just before we go, the next 4 days I do my archives, which will include Kendall Kay and Gary Simoulian and Mike Wofford. And then if you're in LA Thursday night at Kulak Woodshed in North Hollywood, we're presenting for the first in the beginning of the jazz series, Vinnie Golia. I don't know if you know Vinnie.
Yeah, I've heard of him.
Yeah, he's like the king of creative new music, and he's been doing it for years. He's a teacher at at Cal Arts, and he's a multi-woodwindist, and I mean it's going to be really, really wonderful. So come over there if you can on Thursday, and Saturday I'm in Playa Vista at the conference room doing a set and then a jam session. I do that once a month. So that'll be on my website as well. But again, I'm going to highlight Tawanda on Sunday, and that's from 7 to 8:30 in LA. So hope you guys can come. And George, thank you again. It was
You're welcome.
Real fun.
Nice. Thanks for having me.
Pleasure.
Take care.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.